Recording from St. Louis, Missouri, welcome to the Slap Save Pinball Podcast with your hosts, Chris Haper and Jason Fowler.
Welcome to the Slap Save Pinball Podcast. This is episode number 13. Today's date is February 25th, 2019. And we have our celebrity co-host podcaster back in the chair. I'm Jason.
I'm Chris.
Still a little under the weather, aren't you?
Yeah, a little bit. Kids have been sick a couple times. Wife's been sick. Hadn't hit me until last Sunday it started coming on me.
Yeah, it is definitely going around. Well, what's new with you? Have you been able to do any pinball?
Yeah, actually, believe it or not. So, C has left the building, and I will not miss her. Bye-bye. I got, you know, with having Beatles, man, it's just a much better playing game to me. I've said all along, I think it's a sleeper title. And by the judge of Pinside, it seems to be getting more and more traction. So,
yeah,
you know, are they really going to sell out? I don't care. Stern probably made their 1964.
I played it at your house. I thought it played great.
Yeah. You know, before I bought Sea Witch, I had played it a few times. And then a real nice one, it popped up. And I was like, you know, I just need to probably own the game. Give it a good, fair shot. Nope. Still wasn't for me, really.
Yeah.
You know, I'd have some times with it where it was like, yeah, you know, okay, it's cool. But, you know, where my collection's at now, something had to go, and that was a no-brainer for me. So
yeah, it's definitely sensitive to set up. And you're never gonna set it up to where the orbit is repeatable, but I don't think it ever was, even off the factory line. I don't think it was. I think it's more about just drop targets and staying
absolutely
out of trouble. So
yeah. Progress that X around, and you can do that in Beatles. I mean, that's one thing they did leave in. I really dug into Stargazer over the weekend, and yeah, I think I isolated that problem. So right now she's working 100%, not acting like ghostly and possessed and all that. I think maybe there was a couple issues. So, you know, so one thing I found out, you know, with switch tests on an old Stern, make sure that pinball's pulled out, because then then you hit the switches and it shows the numbers on the screen.
Right.
That was kind of a small lesson to learn, because really I haven't had any issues with any Stern machines. And when the machine is in the upright position or the play field, everything was registering, I could get everything to go. And as soon as I lay that back down, a couple switches would kind of be flaky, this, that, and the other. So finally, I just started moving some wires around. All of a sudden, everything went to normal. Played a few games, like, what?
I know, so that's the way it works sometimes. You just, like, start moving stuff around, redoing connectors, rubbing your junk on it. all of a sudden, it just comes back to life.
It was crazy. And it's this one connection where there's actually three wires, and two of the wires on the one side, I just happened to move like a whole 180 degree downward turn, and boom, it came back to life. I'm like, all right, it's got to be a broken out of those two wires. One's got to be broken. And it just so happened right now, everything's making connection. And if it does start acting up again, I'm buying new wire, I'm rewiring those two wires, and I'm done.
Yeah.
So
don't buy a new wire. I've got a bunch.
Oh, is that right? You got orange? Yeah. That might have a stripe on it. I don't know. But
I don't have every single color combination, but I've got a lot of them.
Who cares? Every game in my collection is 100%.
Good.
I love it. So my Munster's LE got the call from JJ last week, or the text. He's like, what number you want? He gave me five numbers to choose from, and one happened to be 131. I was like, just mentally just said that one, that choice was coming to me.
What's the significance of that number?
Well, for me, 13-13. So I've got the 131, and I'm thinking about pulling off the little tag and having one made with the extra three on the end, or have somebody put in the other three. So I don't know.
I gave my review last week. Let's hear yours. Obviously, you own it, so you're a little bit different perspective, but...
I tell you what, this theme is just killer for me. Absolutely killer. Now, my one complaint is the gold trim legs. Do they look like ass? I'm sorry. Just so happens I have a set, an extra set of AC/DC Lucy legs. Don't ask how I got them. And I grabbed one and I held it up to the red on the machine and it's like a perfect match.
Yeah.
So I said, well, these ones are going on. These mustard looking WWELE legs. They're ugly. Put in a couple mods.
A couple mods? Very, what the hell?
Oh, yeah, dude. Oh, yeah. All right, have the speaker light kit. That's a no-brainer, especially on those new Sterns with those big box speakers. Dude, I love those light kits in them. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I had those in. I had Raven's clock put in that I created myself.
So what do you like about the game? What do you think could be done better, if anything? Well, like, give me the rundown.
I think the code lacks. I think it's weak. I hope it gets a little bit better. It's fairly simple, but that's all right. You know, not every game needs to be deep for me. I don't need that. I've got that in my collection. But in terms of artwork, again, Chris nailed the artwork again.
Yeah, he does.
Beautiful. And the color on the playfield, the thing is stunning. Side art, yeah, it's okay. It's not my favorite. I honestly like the side art of the black and white. If that could have been the side art, I would have been happy with that.
Yeah.
The way the game flows, I love it.
Good.
It's perfect for my collection. the lower playfield, I will say, is very much reminiscent of Family Guy. Now, I own Family Guy, and I think Family Guy's upper playfield is one of the best upper playfields ever produced out there. Yeah, it's kind of... It's got that toyish feel to it, but I don't know what else to say, really. I mean, you know, obviously you've reviewed the game. You've reviewed the pro. I just like that full feature game. Mm-hmm. It's perfect for a home environment for me.
I certainly would. I think in the case of this game, I think the premium is probably the way to go.
You really have to love that theme.
I was born in 76. So right. By that time, you know, cartoons had kind of taken over, you know,
right. And absolutely.
Even yeah. If I was going to go back to something like that, it was Batman. It was Batman 66. That yep. theme was yep. what I enjoyed because black yep. and white to me was very like foreign. I mean, if you like the theme, it's something worth buying.
Yeah.
But if you don't, I think it's a coin drop machine. It really yep. is. Like nothing stuck out to me enough to warrant, you know, kind of maybe offsetting the theme like I've done with some other games. Like, God knows I'm not a big Iron Maiden fan, but that to me was a game that was significantly different enough to justify buying it for me.
See, I was born a little bit earlier, so I grew up. The Munsters, I'm sure I've seen every show 3-4 times. No doubt about it. What about you?
So, my Sea Witch left too. But not permanently. It's getting re-stenciled by Troy down at Top Score. I agree. It doesn't have perfect geometry. I still love the game. He's going to take care of that. And I'm getting it clear coded and everything. And then it'll be everything I want it to be. That was the kind of the weakest link was the cabinet itself. Had a birthday not too long ago. So over the weekend.
Happy birthday the other day.
Yeah, thanks. My wife, bless her heart, she's like, yeah, you know, we're going to do whatever you want to do. And it's like pinball related mostly, of course, because I have a problem. And we went to CP Pinball, which is a famous place here in St. Louis. They have 3 outbuildings full of just about 75 machines, I guess. A lot of you may know Chuck. He is at a lot of the shows. I know he goes to Expo. He's a character and a half. I think he was a guy kind of like us that – the collection just continued to spiral out of control to the point where he needed places other than his house to keep them. And that's how he kind of parlayed that into this business. And it's a fun time. And I'll tell you, every time I go there, his collection is pretty solid.
Ever-changing.
It is pretty solid. It's always changing. And every time I walk out of CP Pinball, and I think a lot of you probably feel this way with location pinball, is you always kind of evolve when you play location pinball. Like, and I say that because whenever I leave there, I feel like there's games that I've changed my opinion on, some for the better, some for the worse. Some just kind of firm up what I feel. Like, for instance, over the weekend, I played Creature. And I absolutely, that was what I kept going back to. I just loved it. And he's got a really nice one that's got like the taillight mods and everything done. And it's an A-list title that's very worthy of that. He's got a Spider-Man there. It's just a standard old one, but I'd love to have a black Spider-Man. That just speaks to me for some reason.
You don't think that's too similar to maybe Star Trek?
It's somewhat similar. I don't know. Maybe it's the theme. I think I'm guilty of liking that theme enough to where it
doesn't matter.
Yeah. Guardians is very, you know, close to Metallica, honestly. Oh, yeah. But I love that difference on the left-hand side with that rocket kickback and stuff. And I think the Pro is one of the best examples of Stern doing a Pro better than anything else. Like, no offense if you own a premium out there, but I would love to hear your opinion on why you bought the premium. Because it's one of those instances where there is not much offered, and what is offered is more a negative to me with Groot's hands, all over, and you can't see anything. Yeah. And there's actually mods to get rid of the hands. It's like, right.
And then there's also mods to add the hands.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess
for the Pro.
Yeah. I guess if they're transparent,
I agree with you on those hands being in the way.
Yeah.
You know, the only thing that really I do enjoy is the color changing inserts.
That's not even a for sure thing anymore. Like Deadpool's inserts, more than half of them are RGB.
Yeah. But, on the Pro, you know, you just have solid colors where
it depends on the premium. Title. Like, it's what I'm saying. Well, Deadpool's Pro has that.
I'm talking on Guardians.
Oh, on Guardians. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm staying with Guardians theme here. That, you know, that would be the one thing that I would, if I wanted to bring in a Guardians, I probably would consider the premium just for that light alone. I just, you know.
Right. Well, while I was there, it's like other games that I've never cared for, and for whatever reason, Aerosmith and Twilight Zone, it just kind of confirms I still don't like those.
Yeah.
Monster Bash, I played it there because I was interested. I think last week you weren't here, but I was mentioning that the right feed on Monster Bash is just the way it's designed is kind of a...
So it plays like the original then?
Exactly. Yeah. And I mean, it's true to the original,
well,
for better or worse, but I've seen better and worse too. So like the one at Chuck's was feeding that right flipper a little cleaner than what my remake is. And I am having some discussions right now with some of the fine folks at CGC and Planetary. And we're going to try to get to the bottom of that. I'm warming up to Pirates. I didn't play it at CPs, but they have it at another place called Padavans here in St. Louis. And I think Pirates is a great game. I monitor that thread, and I'm a JJP fan. I own three of them as of this week, I will. And I love the games when they work properly, but I feel like Pirates was maybe rushed out the door a little bit too quickly, and they've got some things to figure out. And by the time I'm confident in it, it's not going to be made anymore. So
and the sad thing is there was a big delay too.
Yeah, I'm telling you, there's something more to that than what we know. I don't even know how to speculate on what that might be, but something didn't jive with that entire release and then how it's been cut off early. Something's not right.
Yeah.
I'm glad I didn't buy one. No offense to those of you that did. I know it's a great game when it's playing right. I really enjoyed it. I think if I had it at my house and I really got an opportunity to know the code and understand what I'm supposed to be shooting for, it would be even better.
I still kind of wish that it wasn't Pirates of the Caribbean.
Absolutely.
You know, you didn't have it all. Just you should have made a Pirates game. And I think their sales would have increased dramatically on that one.
Like a high-end Black Rose.
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly. Something, just make it your own. If you can't get everything, you really need to have that discussion about, maybe we should just make it a general theme and do our own deal.
Right.
And now, Slap Save Pinball's 60-second news.
All right, number one, Munster's LEs are shipping, if you didn't hear Chris talking about his basement. Number two, Stern has revealed their Stern Insider membership program, which amounts to a paywall-type program where you pay $30 per year to get access to super-secret pinball things, including photos and videos of Gary chewing leftover meatloaf, Gary drinking vodka, Gary yelling at interns, Gary doing the throat-cutting motion below a bill of materials graphic. Stern is purported to have three music licenses. I can't tell you what they are because paywall. Path of Play is building a sensory-friendly area at Replay FX for children with special needs. Daniel Spoller from Project Pinball painstakingly reconditioned a World Cup Soccer 94 and delivered it to Oregon Health and Science University in memory of a Tyler Van Pelt who lost his battle with leukemia. It was a beautiful machine. What do you think, Chris? What's your opinion on the Stern Insider membership program?
Come on, really? $30 Stern?
If I may. I don't understand this more than anything else I've seen Stern do. And that is, Stern is riding a mountain of momentum right now, right? And I don't know if this is them and the bean counters just being like, you know what? We could squeeze $30 a year out of a few more people here. But the problem is you're doing that at the expense of the networking of your information of your, about your machines.
Were we being squeezed on the machines that we buy from them?
Yes.
That's, you know, it's one thing to sell t-shirts and hats and all that. I'm cool with all that. I've bought a couple Stern items like that.
Sure.
But, man, to fleece me for $30 and I've got a lineup of LEs, forget it, dude. You know?
Like, I'm not throwing numbers here that you've spent, but I'm saying there's people out there that have spent $60,000 easily on Stern pinball machines in their house. In their house. And you're asking them for $30 a year to get some YouTube videos showing how to play their machines. To me, it's a slap in the face. It really is.
It is.
And it's at the expense of your very business. Like, so you're telling people, rather than giving them information that's going to fuel them to want to buy their machines,
right,
you're trying to squeeze them for another 30 bums.
$30, exactly.
Which is going to do what?
Yeah. Like, it's
not even a case of vodka.
Dude, it's just a slap in the face, really.
To me, is
the way I just kind of look at it. Anybody that buys a machine from them, throw it in there. Hey, give them 6 months.
That's
free access.
Idea. Yeah. And maybe then they get a little bit of a taste of it and then they come back. Or worse yet, they're so impressed with your machines and what you're putting into them and what you're providing is after sale that you actually buy another one. I just don't. I don't know.
Yeah. Or you buy that $500 topper.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. The piece of plexi with some lights around it.
And Ghostbuster topper.
Yep. Oh, I know. Cindy, for my birthday, gave me a piece of paper with the Batman topper on it. Like she said, this is your birthday present. I didn't want to do it. Here it is because I know you want a topper for that machine. So I had the okay and I went in and I got on the laptop and I went to a site that I knew had it and I couldn't do it. It's $400 for a piece of plastic with a graphic on the front and an LED light around the back. And it grinds my gears so bad. It's not the money. I knew I was cleared on it. It's just the fact. It's the premise. You are taking advantage of the very people that you should be taking the best care of.
Right.
The ones
that have been keeping you afloat for years.
Yep. I love you, Stern. But I'm telling you, we're going to tell you when we think you're f***ing up and you're f***ing up.
You're f***ing up for sure.
Yep. So Path of Play hits a little bit of a soft spot for me. I've got two really good friends, you know who you are, that have autistic children, special needs children. And Path of Play is a fantastic program that I think everybody should do anything they can with. In fact,
so is Project Pinball.
Project Pinball is as well. I have spent a lot of money with them. Every time I lose, I'm actually happy because I feel like either way, it's still going to something that it should. I've offered to volunteer to help repair machines. I know Daniel has a lot of help with that. But yep. Anytime, Daniel, you need help with a hospital here in St. Louis, I am your guy if you need it. So, yep.
Yeah, if you need a machine waxed, just come in, you know, just conditioned a little bit. You know, wipe down front backs of the glass, wipe down the whole machine, whatever. Yeah, don't hesitate.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I'm in and out of hospitals more times in a month than most humans just because I do business in them. So
I was diagnosed.
It's not beyond a reach for me.
I was diagnosed at 10 years old with type 1 diabetes, juvenile diabetes. And that's another thing. Charlie up at Spooky is very passionate about JDRF. And obviously I would be too. And I spent a week at Cardinal Glennon here in St. Louis when they were basically showing me how to give myself shots and stuff like that. And at 10 years old, that's tough to swallow. And I just look back and I think, how cool would it have been to keep my mind off of things to have a pinball machine? And now I know Children's here in St. Louis has a pinball machine thanks to Project Pinball. But what I would like to do at some point really, really soon is for Chris and I to sit down and decide something, whatever it is, just a charity that's pinball related that is close or hits home with us, and that we not only do things ourselves for that charity, but also encourage any of you guys that want to support us in a way that isn't just like giving us money, because we really don't want you to do that. But if you can help one of these charities and we can all do it together kind of as a family or as a crew, I think it would be something cool to do. So,
yeah, absolutely.
The Full Plunge.
Okay, so for Full Plunge, we wanted to talk a little bit about the top places to play location-based pinball if any of you ever find yourselves rolling through St. Louis. And the nice thing about St. Louis is we don't have the scene that Chicago does, but given the size of our city, we have a pretty good representation of good pinball places here in St. Louis. And I'm just going to run through those. Chris is going to talk about them a little bit, and we'll go from there. So yep. The first one is Padavans. Padavans is up in an area in northern St. Louis called Newtown. Great yes. place. What do you know about Padavans, Chris?
So Padavans, he does like New York style pizza.
Great food.
And
yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Good food. Small bar, but a full bar. You can get anything there. And he's probably has, I don't know, 14, 15 machines. Pretty much on constant rotation. A good guy there who's been in the hobby for years.
Brian
Bannon, yep. who is a big collector, routes his games there, keeps them very nice shape. He's always got them playing just about 100%, if not 100% all the time, which is real nice. He takes care of them real good, constant maintenance on them. And, you know, and usually has, you know, he typically gets every new game.
He does.
So, which is nice. So, you know, right now, well, you were just there, you know, they got Pirates. They had a Monster Bash remakes, one of their newer ones.
Total Nuclear Annihilation.
Yeah, they got a TNA there. Yep.
Yeah, they've got a great lineup. They really do.
Yeah. Yeah, so the food's really good. Greg, the owner, is real nice, super helpful. He's always there playing the games. So.
They're really big on league play. Really big. Mm-hmm. They've got a great leagues there.
They do.
We don't participate in them. They're kind of on the other side of town for us.
Yeah.
It's a little tough to get to.
I did one summer. I did a league one summer. You know, it's a great location.
All right. Moving on is CP's. And CP's is on the eastern side. There is a huge group of refineries in Roxana, Illinois. Actually, I think it's called South Roxana, Illinois.
It is.
And Chuck, who owns, he's the C in CP's, owns, it's basically three buildings that are full of pinball machines. It's an old house and two large sheds.
So actually, it was an old post office. And then Chuck took over that property. I'd go there on the weekends. It used to be, you know, $10, and he'd be open from 6 p.m. till midnight. And he used to do it two weekends, both Friday and Saturday nights a month. And you could go onto his website and check out his schedule, what weekends it was. And so there were some nights, you know, I went back to back Friday, Saturday night. I took off and went up there. And
So he has, it's no beer. It's bring your own beer, which is a good thing to me. Bring your own food. They've got a few snacks, sodas, stuff like that. There's about 75 machines.
Put your own drinks in it.
Yep. His collection is always cycling. There's always new things coming in and going out. The games, for the most part, they do get a little more wear and tear than Padavans, but they're still, considering the amount of machines there and the size of the operation and the number of games that are being put on them, they are in generally in pretty good shape.
And Chuck, as of recent, you know, because there was time where he closed down for about 6 months or 9 months.
He got burned out, didn't he?
He got burned out big time. And, you know, and
he's only open one day a week. It's only on Saturdays.
His games were suffering.
Yeah.
And, you know, they weren't being cleaned and taken care of. And, you know, last time I was there, man, he's done a 180 on his machines, and they're looking real nice.
Well, he's got a guy there that works there that, man, if he finds out something's not working right, he busts out the soldering iron, whatever it takes. He's working on it right then and there. So,
nice.
And between him and Chuck himself, yeah, they stay up on it pretty well.
Yep.
So the next one is the Silver Ballroom and the Waiting Room. And those are two separate places, but they are owned by the same guy, same couple. Yep. You want to talk about those, Chris?
Yeah, so Doc, hell of a guy. This guy is an Aussie who's living in St. Louis. Dude, yeah.
He's Australian. He makes meat pies they'll rock your world.
Oh, yeah, they will. You know, you can get yourself a 2x4 beer there, and, you know, he's got the coin machine going. Get yourself a handful of quarters. So right now, I think it's Silver Ballroom. He's got about 20 games. Now, Silver Ballroom really was the first pinball that I can remember that really dedicated himself to pinball.
He's always got a really cool eclectic collection too. He's not getting just like, he's got different stuff. Like he had America's Most Haunted. He's got Alice Cooper's Nightmare Castle. They just released at Waiting Room. I haven't been to Waiting Room yet, but I've been to Silver Ballroom, and Chris and I are just talking about
wanting to get
up there.
They got about 10 games at the Waiting Room.
Yep.
And Doc recently partnered in that restaurant deal. So I know it's him and his wife plus another guy.
Okay.
Doc's been in the area. He runs quite a few leagues, quite a few tournaments. So if that's your game, for sure, that's one good place to go.
Yep. Those are located more in the city. And then moving a little bit further out, we have finally Two Plumbers. There's others in the city, but these are kind of our four favorites. And Two Plumbers is a nod to the Mario Brothers, the discreet nod. But they have a lot of video games. They have like a lot of classic video games. And they've got
a lot of board games.
A lot of board games. They've got craft beer. If you are a craft beer fan, it is – that's my favorite part of that place. Their machines are good. They've got a pretty decent collection and stuff.
Yep.
But if you add that with the craft beer, that's right in my wheelhouse.
Those are really some of the top places. Now, I'm sorry if we haven't mentioned some of the others, but you can go to Pinball Maps and, you know, you can see the list of locations. But yeah, out of, you know, if you want to have a variety of play and you're in this area, I highly recommend those four places. They're very, very worth stopping in.
And if you roll through here, make sure you send us a message, and chances are we'll come out and meet you and have a game or two and have a beer.
Brick Shot, the segment where the guys rant about some of the worst misses in pinball.
It's been probably 3 weeks at least since I've heard Chris have just a down and dirty Brick Shot, and I'm due. I have a need for just that anger. So,
Brick Shot. Oh yeah. Oh, all right. So let's talk. And I know you can chime in on this one. You know, I got the speaker light kits, and I really enjoy them on the new Sterns, especially with those big square speakers. They're just so odd looking, like they need something. There's no character to them. And you go to speakerlightkit.com. Dude, these light kits are perfect.
Right.
Good quality. Nice metal frame, and here's the biggest thing. They give you a connector that will connect right into a solid power source, okay? You're not having to use no alligator clips, dude. I cannot stand mods with alligator clips. Who is still doing that nowadays? Like, I don't get it.
Mm.
There is enough technology nowadays that... You don't need alligator clips.
I agree.
Figure it out. If you guys are producing these mods, You know, honestly, measle mods, they do a real nice job. They give you the pride. You know, if it's a stern nowadays, you know, you got a lot of those middle connectors where it's like a little Z that, you know, clips, you know, one end and the other end. And it just kind of fits right there in the middle. Why can't everybody do that?
Without naming names, I agree 100%. Nuts. Yeah, I went out like on a just a tirade the other day when I was on the phone with Chris about this. And here's the thing. It's all proportionate to what you're spending, right? Like if you're spending, I don't know, a nice chunk of change on a mod, like
it's a dollar, dude.
Yeah.
It's a dollar, $2. Really? For a connector that can go right into your pinball machine and connect perfectly, nice, clean, no bullshit.
Yeah.
Why don't we have these?
It doesn't make sense to me because right now you've got a lot of games have shaker motors on them and games have tons of moving parts underneath and you're constantly nudging them. Things are going to come disconnected. Just banana clips, alligator clips, they're not the answer. I'm telling you.
No.
If you do it, if you're a mod maker and you do it, I'm asking that you please consider making the mods, if you are trying to appeal to a large number of different manufacturers and games, split them up. Here are the ones for this manufacturer so you can connect it this way. I would pay $20 more for that privilege.
Oh, absolutely. And you shouldn't have to pay $20 bucks more.
No.
Is the biggest gripe I have about it. You know, and if, I don't know, make, you know how it's Measle Mods. They make the multi-connector so you can buy that and plug it in. And then you can plug in, you know, a bunch more of their mods.
Yeah,
it's like a
Z-connector. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. You know, anybody that's a mod maker out there, dude, take notes, okay? Yeah. Figure it out. Do your homework before you release the mod, okay? Otherwise, you don't make it for that game, period. If you can't figure out a clean power source, don't make it.
Yeah.
I don't want that. Period. I'm done.
I'm done.
I'm done.
I love it.
It pisses me off. Dude, it pisses me off to no end that alligator clips are still an accepted way to tie things in. It makes zero sense to me.
You're not going to get much of a rebuttal from me because you know, this is one of my pet peeves. You know it. So well done. Well said. I agree 100%. We probably ought to wrap things up because we're running a little long by our standards.
And if you got any feedback on those comments, okay, please send it to flippingoutpinball at flippingoutpinball.com. And we will take all your beefs and considerations.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So you know what we ought to do is have a little second where anything that we're looking for, we ought to like just call out. So if anybody has anything out there, is there anything you're looking for machine wise?
Let's
keep it short. One or two. I know you've got like a whole like buffet, a cornucopia of games that you want, but still maybe one or two.
Nope. Nothing right now. I'm good.
Creature. I'd do I'm creature. Solid. I'd do a Star Wars premium for the right price.
What's that right price though?
Yeah, it's got to be the right price.
I
see it.
You can't just throw it out there and say a right price. Okay.
Watch me.
You got your number. What's your number?
Me.
You get pissed off at the people that want you to make an offer first. What's your price?
Well, it depends. You can't say that I've got one price that's going to cover every game
because
some have been
straight,
routed.
Straight up, not modded, plain Jane, Star Wars premium. What's your number?
Home use only?
Yeah, absolutely. Home use only.
I mean, 58. Nobody's gonna take 5,500. I wouldn't.
58.
But I would do six, and some change.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it depends on what it is. I'm super particular. You might have heard that.
Well, we know what it is.
Yeah.
It's a home use only Star Wars premium.
Right. Right. Right.
Strict bone. That's what it is.
Right. Right. But okay. Yeah, creature, Indy 500. I really like one of those. Anyway, we'll wrap it up. This has gone too long. We would like to encourage your feedback, suggestions, comments, and we'd also like to encourage you to send us some liquor. Did I say that? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Leave a review on
Some homebrew too, some hooch.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Break some of that out.
Yeah, we don't need
Patreon.
Put it
in a milk jug. I don't care.
We don't need Patreon. We need Patron. Anyway, leave a review on one of the major podcast websites. Let us know what we could do better or what we are doing good. And
please, if you send an email to us, just make sure it's the right podcast.
There's Troy, right?
Yeah, buddy.
Troy sent us an email today, and it was he meant to send it to Ken and Bill, our good buddies up at Special One Lit, and we got a kick out of it. We were
classic.
So now.
And the funny thing was is that I knew exactly where it was from.
I did too. Yeah. We listened to all the podcasts. We know what's going on. Right. Well, you can contact us at email. That's the best way to get a hold of us at slapsavepinballpodcast@gmail.com. You can get us on our voicemail comment line as usual. That number is 314-529-1875. Get us on Facebook. You can get us on Pennside, Instagram, Twitter. Chris streams on Twitch. I'm sure he's going to be getting back into that before too long because he'll be feeling better. That's slap save underscore. Thanks for joining us, guys. Stay tuned for the next episode. We love talking about pinball. We're just having a blast doing it. Thanks for joining us. We will see you next time about the same time. So,
yeah, buddy.
See ya.